Hello, I am Bob, and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining Channel. In this build series episode, I'm going to cover the start of my budget home immersion mining build. So with that, let's get started. But before starting with the build, I want to mention some sponsors of the channel, starting with Brains and their Brains Toolbox app. Now, for those of you with only a single miner, you can log directly into the Brains OS Plus firmware to manage your miner operation. But once you expand your mining operation to more than just one miner, logging into each miner separately is a real pain. And this is where the Brains Toolbox app comes in. The Brains Toolbox app is a free downloadable miner management tool that gives you a single interface to manage all of your miners. It works with miners running stock Bitmain firmware, as well as with miners running the Brains OS Plus firmware. From this app, you can do everything you need to manage your devices. You can install or upgrade your miner firmware, remotely locate or reboot your miner, start and stop mining, configure your mining pool, and adjust your auto-tuning and dynamic performance scaling settings. You can make these updates one miner at a time or organize your miners into groups so that you can do any of these operations across whole batches of your mining farm. The app has an awesome graphical user interface, but if you are a power user and want to develop scripting or utilize the tool's more advanced capabilities, there is a complete command line interface that gives you full functionality of the tool. And so, whether you're running two miners or 2,000 miners, the Brains Toolbox app is an essential tool to running your mining operation. Now, my next sponsor is Scott's Crypto Mining and the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp. In the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp, you'll learn everything you need to know to launch your first megawatt of Bitcoin miners in less than 3 months. The Build-A-Mine Bootcamp is taught by Scott himself, and you'll be joined by other entrepreneurs and business owners like you who want to learn how to stack more sats faster through Bitcoin mining on an industrial scale. To get in on this fantastic opportunity, just click the link in the description below. And last up is a brand new sponsor of the channel, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions, which is a perfect match for home mining. Altair is your one-stop shop for any mining hardware you might need. They have everything from the latest and greatest miners to every hashboard, cable, and part you might need to repair your existing hardware or build your own 120-volt home-built miner. Altair has years of experience working in the Bitcoin mining industry, including running their own Bitcoin farm, and they've worked with all different scales of mining operations. Altair is based in the U.S. and has top-rated customer support. And so if you have any question about anything at any time, they are there to help you out. Altair is a huge supporter of the home mining community, so if you're looking to buy your next miner or miner parts for your home setup, check out their website at the link below. You'll find pretty much everything you'll ever need. Okay, so in past build episodes on this channel, I've been covering the build of my home immersion system. It's a two-miner setup using 240-volt power and is large enough to provide heat for my house and preheat my water. It's based on the commercially available DCX Bitpod system, which is a fantastic platform for this type of setup. But here's the thing. Building an immersion system of this scale and size may not be for you. Getting into immersion mining can be a huge investment in both time and money, and you might be short on one or both of these. In addition, starting out in immersion can be a little intimidating. You have to learn all about Bitcoin mining and then get familiar with all the ins and outs of immersion technology on top of that, then figure out how to integrate this with your home heating systems. It can be a lot to take in all at once. Also, you might have some limitations on where you can build your mining setup. Maybe it's in a smaller garage, or maybe just an apartment setting where you just don't have access to a lot of space or high current 240-volt power. In any case, I thought it might be useful and kind of fun to build an alternative to a full-size immersion system. And so in the next few episodes, I'm going to cover the build of a small, budget-conscious home Bitcoin immersion mining setup. This build will be based on mostly off-the-shelf components and will use parts and tools found at my local hardware store with minimal customization. Now, although I think this system will be able to handle a full-size Bitmain miner, I'm going to build a 120-volt Bitcoin immersion mining rig using hardware from my new sponsor, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions, so this entire system will run on 120 volt power. Now, just like with my home build, my goal is to build a solid, reliable system that will run for a long time without issues. I'll be selecting parts and components I think should hold up over time, but a word of caution. Treat these videos as a source of ideas or a starting point for any mining setup you might want to build. I'll definitely be trying new ideas and new hardware as I go. I'm hoping that everything will work, but to be honest, I'll likely be making a few mistakes along the way. And so you might want to wait a few episodes before trying anything here yourself, because I'll definitely let you know if something doesn't work out. Now, the first decision to make in my budget build is whether to build a dual loop or a single loop system. I've covered the differences between these two in a past episode, but if you want me to get into those details again, leave a comment below and I'll find some time in a future episode to cover this again. And the selection here is pretty straightforward. For a budget build, less pumps, less piping, and less heat exchangers means less hardware to buy and to build. So my budget build is going to be a very simple single loop design, and this means I have three main components to cover: the tank, the pump, and the radiator. And the first of these components to cover is the tank. Now, I covered tank design in a previous episode, including a lot of design guidance on tank sizing and dimensions, but in this build, I'm not going to be building a new custom tank, as I found in my first system build that can be really costly. Instead, I'm looking for a cheap pre-made tank that will work for a single miner system. I ordered a bunch of different types and sizes of pre-made tanks from different manufacturers and chose a tank that I think will work. And this is what I chose, a fish tank. This tank is a Model 30T made by Ultim Nature Systems. They are a tank distributor. You can buy these through other companies. And this tank is about as small of a tank as you can use and still fit in a full-size S19 miner. As you can see in these photos, it barely fits. You have to take off the control board cover to make it work. Now, in my tank design episodes, I mentioned fish tanks and I noted some of their downsides. First, you have no idea what they're using to seal all these seams. You really don't know how that's going to hold up to that dielectric fluid. And the way I address that here is I put a layer of silicone on each of the joints. As you can see, I use red silicone. The only reason why is I had it handy and it shows up really well on camera, but clear silicone would have worked just as fine. And as you can see in this video, I did a little masking. That's not necessarily, but it made things look nice and clean and neat. Now, the second big issue with using fish tanks is getting the fluid in and out of the tank, which brings up the next component of this design.
And that is the dielectric fluid circulator pump. Now, most circulator pumps normally really don't do well in suction. They aren't made to pull fluid up into the pump. In fact, here is the install instructions from the pump in my home heating system, making it really clear that you shouldn't try to pump fluid over the tank wall. So with this fish tank, there are only a few options for integrating the circulator pump. First, I could cut a hole in the side of the tank. Now, the tank is made of glass, so that's really not something I'm comfortable with. And from what I've learned from watching some YouTube videos, this would take specialized tooling and some practice, so that's really not a great option here. The second option is to buy a cheap pump and just use it wrong. I found lots of really cheap knockoff circulator pumps on Amazon. I could just take one of these and install it above the tank and just see if it has enough power to pull the fluid up into the pump. And if it burns out, I could just replace it with another. But as I noted in the beginning of this episode, I really want to make something that should last, so I'm going to skip on this option for now. And that brings up the third option, and the one I'm going with, which is to use a circulator pump the right way, which means putting the pump inside the tank with the fluid. Now, in my cooling pump episode, I made a comment that this can be kind of risky since normal circulator pumps are really not designed to work within immersion fluids. You really don't know how the dielectric fluid will interact with the pump bearings, housing, electronics, and how long the pump will last working this way. Also, with this tank, I really don't have a lot of room to work with, and pretty much any circulator pump I found was just too big to fit inside the tank along with the miner. So I had to search and find a very special pump that was tiny and made to work submerged in a hot dielectric fluid, and I think I found exactly the right pump, and that is model 893-10 24-volt DC pump made by March Pumps. This is a fully submersible and fully sealed pump designed to handle operating within harsh chemicals up to 130 degrees Fahrenheit. Here's the pump curve chart, and what this shows is that if I wanted to run a full-size miner at about 3,000 watts, and I keep the flow resistance in the rest of my cooling loop really low, this pump should have just enough pumping capacity to keep things cool. And it should definitely have enough fluid flow for my low-power 120-volt miner. As you can see in this photo, it's really small and will just fit into the tank along with the miner, and it uses less than 5 watts of power. Now, this pump does have a downside, and that is it's an industrial-grade pump and not cheap. I got mine for $320 on sale. This is a huge expense in building this budget system, and this is why buying a cheap pump and seeing if it might work with a bad install might be a better approach to try. Now, to get the fluid from the pump out of the tank, I put together a quick assembly using silicone tubing, hose clamps, some brass fittings, and some PEX tubing. I'm using my favorite thread sealant for dielectric threaded fittings, Loctite 554, but to be honest, this fitting is inside the tank, so if it leaks a little, it's really not going to be that big of a deal. Using the silicone and PEX tubing is an idea I got from Michael Schmidt from Nakamoto Heating Solutions. He's one of the OGs in home immersion. I've got his website and Twitter handle below. If you're not following him, you really should. Now, I'm going to be using PEX tubing for most of the fluid lines in this build. It's cheap, easy to work with, and easy to find in most home improvement stores, and it should hold up to the dielectric fluid, too. Now, with the overall tank and pump picked out, last up is a couple design details to make this setup work. And the first of these is the flow separation wall within the tank. This is needed to ensure the cold fluid flows up through the miner and the hot fluid is removed from the top of the tank. Unfortunately, this is not something you can buy online because this has to be built into the tank. Lucky for me, I have a family member who has a small laser cutter, and so I was able to work with him to build a custom flow separation wall. As you can see, the design is super simple. Just 5 parts cut from acrylic plastic sheeting, which fit together using a very simple slotted design. I used a little more silicone to hold these parts together, and I've designed this to both support the pump and to space the wall out from the side of the tank. Now, if by chance you choose to duplicate this design and want to use this flow separation wall in your own tank, contact me at the email address below. I can give you the dimensional drawings or put you in contact with someone who can build these parts for you at a small fee. The last part of the design to cover in this episode is the flow plate underneath the miner, and with this build, I'm going without one. The tank is super small, so there really isn't a lot of room under the miner for a flow plate, and with the miner reaching all the way to the edges of the tank, there's really not a need for a flow plate. All I have to do is get the cool fluid underneath the miner, and the fluid flow should take care of itself. And so I'm just going to run 2 pipes underneath the miner and put holes in the sides of the pipes to distribute the fluid under the miner. The PEX piping is solid enough to support the miner, so the piping does dual duty here, both supporting the miner and distributing the cold fluid underneath the miner. And here's the completed tank and pump assembly ready to connect to my radiator. You can also see my 120-volt immersion miner inside, and that is going to be the topic of my next video. I'm going to go step by step through my miner build. Like, subscribe so you don't miss any new episodes coming your way, and with that, bye!